ורחי נפשי יש השם הלב יקפן. Page 100, the Talmud tells us, אינו דומה מי ששונה 100 פעמים ל-101 פעמים. You cannot compare someone who study 100 times to someone who study 101 times. Hard to believe to be here this morning, not only with our team, but with a new fellow to our team, direct descendants of the Vilna Gaon. How do you like that? It's a privilege and honor to have you here with us, Larry.
Thank you.
And what we're going to study in page 100, number one, we're going to complete the subject of one overlapping the other, which is the Tum'ah and Tahara. Then we're going to study the continuing of the study of Hilchot Hotza'ah ve'Hachnasah, carrying from one domain to another. And if time allowed, we'll also go to the part of a practical halachot. 104 lines from the top of the page. Shemen al gabei ayin machloket Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri ve'Rabbanan. If there is a floating oil floating on the wine, it's a dispute between Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri and Rabbanan. This is Gemara in Yevamot, page 74, dealing with Sheni Letuma'ah, which is, if you have a Tevul Yom meaning someone who wasn't pure for a certain period of time, and he completed his time of segregation, in a sense, he is not in a state of purity, and at the last day, before he ducked himself in a mikveh, this is the day that he is basically, in one hand, ready to be pure, on the other hand, he physically did not duck himself because the day did not complete it. So as far as they make the contribution impure is a different status. Just background, touching an impure or vice versa, touching a pure contribution to the temple by someone who's not pure can contaminate it and create a state of impurity which make it invalid for service. So here you have an oil that flowing, oil that it's from someone who donated, it was a contribution, and it was floating on the top of wine that was also a contribution. Venagat vulyom, and someone, ditnan, that someone who's not in a state of full purity, in other words, he is the last day of the time of impurity, but he's in a state of just ready to complete the seventh day. So what happened is, in case of floating one, and one was immersed himself during the day, one was impure, immersed himself in a ritual bath, but not because of completely pure until sunset, touched the oil. So what happened? He invalidated only the oil and not the wine. So that's Chachamim's opinion. So even you tell me that the oil is floating and it touched the wine has not become invalid because of that, because the fellow that touched it, it's not a person that is completely impure, but it's Tvul Yom, it's a person that it's not ducking yet, because I meant or duck, but the day is not completed, it's not sunset. So therefore, he cannot carry on and make impure another truma, another contribution. Rabbi Yochanan ben Uri omer, Shnehem chibur ze laze. We considering the oil and the wine connected to each other, and since they are intermingled, in a sense, the oil and the wine are part of each other, so therefore he made the oil impure, the wine was also impure. Now, you ask me a question, so what this has to do with our discussion, which is carrying on Shabbat? So because the sages tells us that the oil is a separate entity and not part of the wine, so because the oil is floating on the top of the wine, it's not considering as melechet hotza'a, it's a caring type of labor, and therefore if you the same way as you said that if you have a nut vessel and a vessel in flowing or the water, that's what we concluded the previous sentence. We said that this it's not considering a munach, it's not considering permanently staying there, so therefore they say that only the oil is impure in that sense, but nothing else in our discussion. But according to Rabbi Yochanan ben Nuri, that he hold that wine and the oil are intermingled and they one part, so therefore we don't considering the oil as a separate entities, and therefore a water cannot be a contribution independently, Rashi said. So therefore we have to have them as one part. Now, as far as the Shabbat, if you're considering all of that in so one part, so therefore you can call it as a melechet hotza'a, that it's a caring from one domain to another. So if you recall earlier in page 99, we talk about chulia, if it was a pit and it's a corner of the pit. So the minute you put that part, that piece inside the pit, so you reduce the amount of the depth in the pit. So here we said, Amar Abaye, Bor Birshut Arabim, Amuka Asara Urchava Shmona. If there is a deep in a public domain, a deep, they dig very deep in a pit, that it's in the 10 hand breadth. 10 hand breadth, it's already considering a pit. And the width has a Urchava Shmona, it's a 8 hand breadth wide. And Vezarak Letocham Machzelet, and one throw it to a mat into it. So they said liable. Why? Because it's considering achnasa from getting in from public domain to private domain. Chilka b'machzelet, but he divided the pit with mat, which means he put it in and he divided to two pieces. So basically, it's a different state. Why? Because he's now doesn't want to deal with the mat. He's dealing with the pit that he divided into two parts. How that can happen? Here is an example. Someone walked and he found a very beautiful or even expensive mat. But it's Shabbat. So what did he want to do now? He wants to save it. So after Shabbat, what did he do? He want to go and pick it up. So what did he do? He put it inside a pit. So now what happened? He changed the status, right? So here is the question. So Abaye said that if they have in that pit 10 hand breadth and wide 8, so he basically, he is liable because he entered from public domain to private domain. However, if he split it, because originally the size of the pit was 8, but because this mat taking part, so now it's less than 8. Now the truth is that some of the Rishonim have issues with that. The Meiri, for example, challenged that. The Maharsha challenged that. Some said, like the Maharsha said, that it's not make the pit in that status. But anyway, here, according to Abaye, if a person put it inside that pit, he changed the status of the private domain. And therefore, he hold that if he left it there, it's not considering a full melacha. Again, here is the depth of that. The whole idea that changing the status, the minutes you do, you put it in the different location. So, in other words, sure, is one idea of leaving, resting that spot, that item. The second question, the second point is changing the status of that domain.
That domain, right?
So they said, according to Abaye, he said that living there over in the pit, it's already make him liable. But it's another difference between them. לאביי דפשיט על ידי מחצלת מבטלה מחיצה. According to opinion of Abaye, of whom it's obvious that the mat eliminates the partition of the pit. So, כל שכן חוליה מבטלה מחיצה. So for sure, if you put a dirt and throw in a pit, and that is a 10 hand breadth deep, so what happened here? So rendering it less than 10 hand breadth eliminates the partition. So why? Because the one who throw it, what do you have in his mind? You have in his mind, as we said the early example, if it's a lost item, right? If he found something. So he wants to leave it there. He doesn't want to use it now, right? So the same as we said in the previous page, if someone throw chuliyah lebo, if someone put it down, so they said chuliyah mevatelet shita de lo mevatla mechitza. So therefore, now according to Rabbi Yochanan, who raised the dilemma with regard to segment of the dirt, it's obvious that the mat does not eliminate the partition. Why? Because again, by putting it, you minimize the shiur. You minimize the size that was there originally. So the Rashba explained here: the minutes you divided it to a different partition, it's a school of thought that the status of that domain changed. So now we go a little deeper with the whole idea of changing that partition and changing the status of the domain. Va'amar Abaye, bo berushut harabim. Abaye said, with a pit in a public domain. So I want to clarify something, especially for those who came here today. When you use the term berushut, it's a common mistake of people to think that when we talk in Hilchot Shabbat, the reshut, it means private domain, it's owned by private person. That's not what we meant. It doesn't mean ownership. Reshut lo be'alut. Reshut is not the ownership. Reshut meaning makom hiluch rabim, a place that most of the people walk or most of the people use. Private, it's used by individual, by a separate personal entity. Doesn't mean that that person owns it. So now we speak about bo berushut harabim. If you have a pit in a public domain, amuka sara uchava arba, if they have 10 hand breadth deep and 4 hand breadth wide, and ve melea maim, that it's filled of water, ve zarak letocha, so someone throws something that that will rest there. For example, if he add more water, or if he throw a stone, right, and the stone will stay at the bottom. So the big question is that considering a labor on Shabbat or not? Now again, reshut hayachid. What is reshut hayachid? It's 10, right? Mm-hmm. 10 hand breadth, right. 4 by 4. You remember?
Right.
That's considering a private domain. Now, if you have a pit of water, so what happened here? He changed the domain from, he entered from one domain to another, which is from private to public domain, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they said, Chayav, he is liable, because the pit is considering a private domain. Melea perot. But if the pit is filled of fruit. So again, you have a pit, you have the site, but it's instead of water, you have here fruit. וזרק לתוכה פטור. But if he throws something to that pit, he is exempt. So you may say, how come? That pit has the size of a private domain because the fruits are filled yet. So how come you said it's different? My tama. So the Gemara said why? Maim lo mevatle mechitzta, peirot mevatle mechitzta. Water, it's not annulling the partition of the pit, Because what happens when you throw something to the water? It goes right to the very bottom. So it means, Meir said, that the water, it's not minimized, or the stones, that the minute you throw it and it goes to the bottom, it's not minimized the size of the pit. However, when it's come to fruit, the fruit itself, what happened is, it's metzamtzemim o mekabor, they eliminate the depth of the pit, and therefore is no longer 10 hand breadth, and now it's considering a public domain. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
So remember, the whole idea of juxtaposition between fruits and water, it's in order to explain to us there are some circumstances that the fruit can, or throwing something to a pit can eliminate the size,
right,
versus situation like water that not. Tanya name achi, hazorek min hayam leistera. If someone throw an object from the sea to the street, and vice versa, umina istera layam patur. And from the street to the sea is exempt. Why? So the basically the sea, it's considering carmelite.
So moving from a carmelite to Rishut Arabim is okay?
It's not a violation of a Torah law.
But it's a violation of rabbinic law.
Yes.
Okay, so it's okay.
Violation of Jewish law, rabbinic law, the minute you move it from carmelite to public domain, yes. Rabbi Shimon Omer, Rabbi Shimon said, "Im yesh b'makom shezarak amok asara v'rachav arba'a chayav." Rabbi Shimon said, "Wait, if in that spot in the sea that you go to the what? So if there is a 10 hand breadths deep and 400 wide, he is liable. Why? Because it's considered hachnasa. It's like entering now into a private domain." So it means that the water in the sea does not eliminate the status of a private domain. Ma'im lo mevatli mechitzot. It's not eliminate that status. Now, the Rambam in Ilchot Shabbat, chapter 14, elaborates on that. And the key point is the Magid Mishneh. He said, when you see this petition, it's not annulling. But the whole Rishonim have a lot of questions here. The whole idea of the status of the sea or the ocean. Because if you talk about petition that covering the oceans, you have an ocean that's covering by petition. Or let's go another thing. You can say the whole world is a Rishut Hayachid. It's a private domain. Or you can say that the whole sea is in that status. So it's a long discussion, but I highly recommend to see the Rambam, Ravid, Magid Mishneh, Olam Mefoshim, Hilchot Shabbat, chapter 14. And now we go to the Mishnah. In the Mishnah we said, "Hazorek arba amot bakotel lemala ma'asarat fachim kezorek ba'avir." So after we discussed in the previous Mishnah in regard to throwing an item from one domain to another, throwing an item in the 4 cubits in a public domain, it's one of those halacha leMoshe miSinai. It's one of those halacha that was transmitted to us, which we believe in our tradition. But even though that's considering one item in 4 cubits in Shabbat, considering a derivative, a tolada of melechet otzah, of the labor of carrying from one domain to another. And therefore, that's what we believe that transmitted to us from Moshe Rabbeinu. So they said, with regard to one who threw an object 4 cubit in the public domain, and by the way, what I'm telling you now, it's based on Rabbeinu Avadya Mebar Tanura, one of the great commentators on the Mishnah. So if someone throw an object 4 cubit in the public domain, if the object hits the wall above the 10 hand breadth from the ground, So we consider that, which is exempt domain, so kezorek ba'avir. It's like thrown in the air, and he is exempt. So, because what's the prohibition? The prohibition is on the person, but meaning by him carrying that from one domain to another. But throwing, it carry a different status. There is a lot of discussion. The Chazon Ish have a lot, and Chatam Sofer have a lot to say. But again, I base that just on Rabbeinu Avadim about the Nura here. So they said, "Lemata me'asara kezorek ba'avir." If he hits the wall below the 10 hand breadth from the ground, so it's considering like someone who throw it in the air. Why? Because we said that the air space is up to 10 hand breadth, right? And the halacha is zorek ba'aretz arba amot chayav. And one who throw an object 4 cubits in the land, he is liable for sin offering. So if you remember, in 96b, we elaborate on this foundation. So the Gemara said, v'ha lo nach. So the Gemara asked, but let's face it, the item did not rest on that standing wall. So there is no placement. Amar Rabbi Yochanan bidvela shmena shanu. Remember when we talk about the fig, the juicy cake of fig that stick in the wall and they throw it against? So that's what exactly the Mishnah is speaking here. But the whole idea why it's considering inside the 4 hand cubits, that there is a, if you remember in the previous page, we have a long discussion over that. Amar Rav Yehuda Amar Rav Amar Rav Chiya Zarak lemala ma'asara v'alcha v'nacha b'chor. If person throw an item, a stone that is in a wall above the 10 hand breadth from the ground, and went and he rest where it was it's a hole in the wall. So here he said kolshu at any size, which is less than 4 cubits. So now what's the point? Point is those holes change the status because it's a hole that you have inside the wall. Banu lemachloket Rabbi Meir v'Rabbanan. That's a machloket that you have at both in a tractate Eruvin and a tractate Yuma. Le Rabbi Meir amar chokekim lachshlim mechayev. Le Rabbanan de'amren chokekim lachshlim lo mechayev. So here is the machloket between the two. According to Rabbi Meir said, one curves out the space to complete, is liable. So it's like you have that part that it's open. It's like making that part from mezuzah. So I want to show you the picture and explain what's involved. You see this picture? Is that clear, everyone? Okay. According to halacha, we have to put a mezuzah in any place that they have at least 10 hand breadth, and here the size has to be at least 4 hand breadth. And now the discussion in Tractate Eruvin is what happened if the top is made like that. It's called kippah, it's like yarmulke, right? That he made like a little small rainbow. So what's the issue? Because the width, it's getting close and close and close and close and close. So here it's a dispute. Rabbi Meir and the sages have this disagreement that in one hand you have the requirement of 10 hand breadth, okay? However, the place, it's already getting small, it's getting 4. So this type of entrance doesn't need to have a mezuzah. Why? Because the whole height is not 4, it's just part of the height is 4, but not the top. So this part, this wall around that rainbow, it's, you have enough space. You see this little spot in both sides? It's enough space to make it a little big and then make it straight. Okay, so the big question is, since you have that option, Rabbi Meir hold chokekim leashlim. Rabbi Meir said that yes, you can move here this part and make it in the sense like a square for the entire place, and they all will be the same way. So if you put it that way, you can put a mezuzah. But the other option is that ein chokikim lashlim, that the potential to take this part out, it's not sufficient to put a mezuzah. So you see here, it's applied to us as well. So in other words, do you basically considering the potential as something that's part of our halachic ruling or not? Tanya Nameachi, Zarak Lemala Me'asara. Another writer that said that if a person throw above the 10 hand cubits, Ve'alcha ve'nacha b'chol korshu, and is run and rest in any hall, Rabbi Meir mechayev ha'chachamim potrim. Rabbi Meir make it liable, and the sages exempt. Now we go to the next discussion, which is tel ha'mitlaket. Imagine if you have a little mountain in a 10 hand breadth, and then it go down in a 4 cubit. So this is like a small mountain, etc. Amar Rav Yehuda, Amar Rav. Tel ha-mitlaket, a mound that is an inclined place that gradually attained high of 10 handbreadth over a horizontal space of 4 cubits. Asara mitoch arba vezarak venach al gabav chayav. So, because there is a concept that is called nicha tashmishtei, that it's a convenience to, for a people, and also there is a concept called aras michta, because that ground is heavy and it's like continuous of a public domain. So they said uchayav, he is liable. Now the subject of tel ha-mitlaket, it's a Rambam in Hilchot Shabbat chapter 14 hold that it's one who throw an object from a public domain and to that spot is liable. Tanya Nameachi, my voice shavel etocho v'naase midron l'reshut harabim. So if you have a alleyway that is level inside and become a higher and an incline or decline plane, so it's already entered to a public domain. So again, it's a mavoi, is alleyway that it changed this. What happened is it's changed this size. It's either became smaller or bigger. So the point is, אותו מבוי אינו צריך לו לחי ולא קורה. So again, let's make it clear. An alleyway that is level inside and become an incline or decline plane. So, and it's enter a public domain, which is a higher or lower than the alleyway. Or if entrance of the alleyway is level when entering the public domain and inside it an incline, that alleyway require neither a post nor a beam, even that it's in that status that it's inclined. So here you see a very similar to tel ha-mitlaket, very similar to the previous discussion. Rabbi Chanina ben Gamliel omer tel ha-mitlaket asara mitoch arba vezarak venach al gabav chayav. Rabbi Chaim ben Gamliel said, mountain that gradually attain a high of 10 hand breadth over horizontal space of 4 cubits. So if someone throw an object from the public domain and he came to rest at the top of the mound, he is liable. So the same as someone who zorek, who throw from public domain to private domain. So basically, it means that both opinion of this brayta it's supporting what Rav said earlier, and that's what the Rashba and Ritva opinion. But again, the Rambam, Ilchot Shabbat, chapter 17, have a lot to explain in this. Now we go to the next Mishnah. Next Mishnah is about throwing an item to a public domain. Zarak letoch arba amot. If one throw an object in a public domain. So now it's get to that spot. Venitgalgel chutz le'arba amot patur. And that item is roll and went beyond the 4 cubits is exempt. Here is my question to you. It means what? That object was hit the ground or not hit the ground? What do you understand? If one throw an object in public domain and he intend to throw it to the 4 cubits and he ends up roll behind the 4 cubits, so he is exempt. So does that mean that item hit inside the 4 cubits and then went outside or not?
I'm saying yes. It landed within four cubits. Sounds like one.
Everyone agree?
Yeah.
Everyone agree?
Yes.
I disagree. Mm-hmm. Okay. Again, if it's a Rabbeinu Hananel and the Rambam in the explanation of the Mishnah elaborate on that, and he said, look, if the person did not intend to throw something that he can make him liable, okay? You remember we talk about Melechet Machshevet, we talk about halachot of damage and damagee. Mm-hmm. If someone intend to do one thing, like throw something in a 2, and he ends up by 4, he's exempt because he is not have the Melechet Machshevet, doesn't have in his mind
the intent.
Okay, so now, the one who throw this item cares where this item ends up or not?
Yes.
Yes? Everyone agree, yes? I disagree. Yes. I think he doesn't care. Because if he cares, we consider that as Melechet Machshevet. It means that he have that thought in his mind. But because he doesn't care, it means that that item can throw further than four cubits. But what happened is, it hits that area, but not the ground. Before he entered the ground, he went out that domain, which means he threw it, he passed that domain of 4 cubits, but end up outside of that domain. So then, how that happened? So most of the Meforshim hold that it was a strong wind. You know, it's now everybody talk about Israel, that they have a very strong winds and snowstorms and things like that, that it's not so usual. It happens in everywhere. You throw something and all of a sudden a strong wind, boom, goes elsewhere. So he basically doesn't care, he throw it. But because you have to know, again and again, what we said so many times, when you come to make someone liable, he needs to have akira and hanacha, which means he need to uproot it from one domain and leave it for another domain. But here, things change while he did it.
But it wasn't his intention to do it. So why is said that he don't care if it wasn't his intention to do that?
Because it's a good question. Because think about it. What happened here? Do we have both entities? Did we have akira and hanacha, or only akira?
They say here, he tossed the object indiscriminately, not intending that it land in any particular place, but the force that he exerted was sufficient to propel it only a distance of 2 amot.
Correct.
So,
you remember, when it's come to Shabbat, what we involve here is Melechet Machshevet. It's very different than damages and any other laws. When Shabbat, it's involved with thought. Anyway, chutz le'arba amot, ונתגלגל לתוך ארבע אמות חייב. And that's the way that they've thought. If one throw an object with the intention of it landing behind the four cubit, and the object roll back within the four cubit, is liable, because what is the originally he throw the object?
Right.
So the Gemara asks, "Ve'alonach?" But come on, the object did not rest behind the four cubit. So why you the one who throw is liable? Amar Rabbi Yochanan, "Vehu shenach al gabei mashehu." Rabbi Yochanan said that it's that part is rest. You can say even in the air. What does that mean in the air? We just said that the strong wind changed the status. Mm-hmm. So in our language, in our mind, it changed the status. That's, by the way, the Rashi and Tosfot and Rashba. Ritva disagree with that, and he said that wind, it's not, and changing the status in the air, it cannot, considering as a rest in the air. He disagreed with that. But anyway, Tanya Nameache, Zarak chutz le'arba amot. זרק חוץ לארבע אמות ודחפתה הרוח וכניסתו. So again, this is a question. If one threw an object beyond four cubits and the wind blew it while still in the air and brought it within four cubits, אף על פי שחזרה והוציאתו פטור, he is exempt, even though the wind then brought it back out and the object did not come to rest in the place where he was thrown. אבל, however, אחזרתו הרוח משהו. If the wind seized it briefly, so the Tosfot said, and it stayed in the ground for a brief period of the time, and it happens sometimes when you have, storms, hurricanes, etc., or strong wind, right? So they said, "Af al pi shechazra veichnisato chayav." Even though the wind then brought it in, that person is liable. Amar Rava, Rava said, "Toch shlosha lerabanan tzarich hanacha." Rava said that what we said in Lavud, you remember that the three, it's the three hand breadths on the ground, according to the rabbis. An object in the airspace is not considering at rest, and the object must come to rest atop of something to establish liability. Yativ marimar v'kamar lehashmata. So, and again, it's all the airspace of what? Of a public domain. So that's the whole discussion. But again, the Chazon Ish have a lot to explain here. I wish to have more time. Yativ Marimar v'kamar la l'ashmata. Marimar was one of the rabbis. He came and he explained this halacha, this brayta. He said what he heard from Rava. Amar lei Ravina le Marimar. So Ravina said to Marimar, just turn the page 100b. Lav hainu matnitin, isn't that what we learn in the Mishnah? So ve'amar Rabbi Yochanan vehu shenach al gabei mashehu. So Rabbi Yochanan said that it's all if that item rests on something. So it means that the object is really land. That's by the way the Rashi, or because in the air. It's standing in the air, you can see helicopters standing in the air, not moving, right? In that sense. But an item in the air, it's a different status. So, big question here is, what did Rava tell us more? What is the Chiddush more than what Rabbi Yochanan said earlier? Amar le, mitgalgel kamar, mitgalgel en sofo lanuach. If you told me in something that is rolling an object, it will not ultimately come to rest because it's rolling object. Aval hai, but here what the Rava said in the some item that eventually is going to the ground, and it's a lavud, it's a tree and bred from the ground. Kevan de sofo lanuach al gav de lo nach keman de nach dame. So since it will ultimately come to rest, even though it has not yet come to rest, it's considered as the object that came to rest. So kamash melan, so therefore Rava wants to teach us that we don't say it. So even in that sense, the sages hold that one is not liable until it actually come to rest upon something. So here we enter to the Mishnah, and the Mishnah speaking about water or sea or ocean. Hazurek bayam arba amot patur. If someone throw an object 4 cubits into the sea, he is exempt. Why is exempt? So I assume you remember we talk about the ocean or the water, it's the din of Carmelit. So because the water, the ocean, it's not considering neither public domain nor private domain. So according to the Torah, you can carry or to throw an item within 4 hand breadth. You can enter from in and out from that domain. Now, how about those partitions? If they have those partitions, so that's a long discussion of the Meforshim, like the Meiri and the Ritva. So we're not going there. But im haya rakak mayim ureshut harabim mehalechet bo. So it's in Hebrew called shlulit, which means if you have a swamp in the public domain passes is through. So what happened is, so people pass by that and azorek letocho arba amot chayav. Why? Because that swamp is considering a public domain because it's less than 10 hand breadth. So it's a public domain. And therefore, one who throw an object 4 cubits into it is liable, like one who carries 4 cubits in the public domain. V'chama urekak mayim, how you deep is the swamp? Pachot ma'asarat fachim, if it's less than 10 hand breadth. So, because if it's more, it's already changed the status from what? From public domain to Carmelit. That was Rashi. Now the Ritva disagree, and the Ritva said that it's a change the status and it's a it can be even a private domain. But anyway, we go here by the way that Rashi and Rambam explain this Mishnah. Kak mayim rushut harabim mehalechet bo azorek betocho arba amot chayav. So he said here, if there is less than in the case that of a swamp in a public domain passes through, and one will throw an object 4 cubits into the swamp, so they said he's liable. So since we discuss this idea of swamp twice in the Mishnah, Amar le'ahu mirabanan le'rava bishlama iluch iluch treizimnei hakamash melan. So they said the passing is mentioned twice, right? So the teachers that the passage under the dureness is considering passage, but uses under the dureness is not considering uses. But hiluch al rabim al deadchak shmei hiluch tashmish al deadchak lo shmei tashmish. Uses under the dureness is not considering uses. So how about ela al rekak rekak meiz min elam li? So again, Tashmish is a place that most of the people get used to walk there. So use it only al ide adchak, only when it's a presses need, like for example, pit in a public domain that they have it 9 hand breadth. But here, ela rekak, rekak, lamali, why we need to mention swap twice? So Rava answered, and he said, the answer is, chad bimot hachamar, chad bimot hagshamim. Remember the historical context. At that time, in the hot summer in Babylon, people walk barefoot. So people use that swamp to cool off the leg. It wasn't the era of air conditioning, etc. So they need that. However, in the winter time is a different story. Utsriche, and we need to mention the swamp twice. Why? The itan achadava mina hanimi lebimot achama davidin shemazgelo kore nafshar velmot akshemim lo. That if we mention only one time, we think that that's apply only to the time of the summer time that people need to cool off, but in the winter time, no. V'yashmin on dibot akshamim. But if we mention only in a case of a winter, what we think? Since people are filthy from mud anyway, so they don't mind walking through the swamp. But the summer, it's not the story. So that's the reason we need to mention the swamp two times, because basically all year around, especially in the historical context, people walking through swamps all the times. Now, the Sfat Emet still have a longer explanation. Is a concept in Talmud that's called Tzrichuta, that we can derive from one to another, and he asks why we don't use it here. Abaye Amar, Itzrich, Sarka Natacha Minane Milecha Deloa Ve'arba Amot, Avalecha De'acha Ve'arba Amot, Akufei, Makfei, Akufei, Makfei. So Abaye said it was necessary the Mishnah to state swamp twice. Why? Because it will have entered to your mind to say that this matter applies specifically where the swamp is not 4 cubits wide, but where the swamp is 4 cubits wide, people basically go around it, right? So that's the reason why we need it. Ravashi Amar Itzrich. Sagala Tachamina Milecha de Ava Arba, Valecha de Loava Arba, Mi Pase Psaile. So Ravashi said opposite. We need it. Why? It's necessary in the Mishnah to state swamp twice because it will have entered to your mind that this matter applies specifically where the swamp is at least 4 cubits. But, so what's the difference? The previous one said that people are circumvented it, they circumnavigate, they go around. But here they say that people jump on it. But where the swamp is not 400 wide, people, what they do, they step over, they like jumping, and do not walk through it. Let's face it, we are in 2013. How many people like to walk to swamp? Only when you are in the Marines training, right? Ve'azda Ravashi le'tame. So Ravazda Ravashi follow his own reasoning. The Amar Ravashi, Haiman de Zarek, Venach Aguda de Gamla Mechayav, Shari Rabim Bokimbo. He said, one who throw an object and came to rest on one of the beams of the bridge is liable, even though the width of each beam is less than 400, it joins together with the other beams to form a single surface of the public domain, because even though many people step over the beams, still many people step on it. So because many people step on it, so therefore that's the way Rav Ashi explained the Mishnah, that we're not considering that people that step on that swamp. The next Mishnah dealing again with carrying in the water and the ocean, Hazorek min hayam layabasha, which means one will throw to a public domain from Carmeli, from the sea or dry land, umin habayasha layam, or from dry land to the sea, ומן הים לספינה, and from the sea into a boat, ומן הספינה לים, and from the boat to the sea, ומן הספינה לחברתה, or from one boat to another, פטו. Why? No, you tell me, what's the reason that he's exempt? Because the sea has a status of what?
Carmelite.
Very good. Now, ספינות קשורות זו בזו, we are in a city of boating here in Maryland, the capital of Maryland. Tons of people here have boat and boating and all different boats, from yacht to speed boats to sailing boats, right? So if, like in these seasons, the boats are tied together, so do we allow to carry from one to another? So the Mishnah said, "Metaltelin mizolazo." One may carry an object from one to another on Shabbat, right? So we said, why we want to carry from one another in Shabbat? So because it's not 4 handbreadth between the boats. That's the reason. Now, the Magen Avraham in Shinun Hei in 355 explained it, that the minutes that you have a space of 4 handbreadth between them, so then is a rabbinic prohibition to carry it, because there is a Carmelite, which is the water, it's in between them. But the key point is, later, in the next page, we learn that these two boats belongs to how many people?
Two
people, not one person, not the same owner. Okay? So the next one is said, Im einam kshurot, af al pi shemukafot el metaltelin ze lazo. But if they're not tied, even though they are have they are adjusted, which adjusted, which means that they are basically have the area that it's covered for one another, that because they are so close to each other, like you call it here the sip, how do you call that spot that you put
slip.
The water? Slip, thank yep. you. So because there is a chance you have the water and they're moving all the time, so they may be distance from one another, 4 handbreadths. So it means again that because you have a Carmelite in between them, the water, so you one cannot may not carry from one to another. So the Gemara say it must fina. So it was stated the sages disagree with regard to what to draw a seawater onto a boat on Shabbat. Ravuna amar motzim ziz, motzim emena ziz kol shu memale. Ravuna said one extended a ziz, a projection of any size from the size of the boat as the distinctive side, and what did they do? He filled the receptacle with water from the sea. You know that many situations that people need it for many purposes to use that that part. To put water in, etc. The Mishneh Berurah and Shinun Hei explain it. We go there later. Now, Rav Chisda and Rabba Bar Avuna Amrei Ose Mekom Arba'a Umemale. It's not enough, but what he need to do, he said, he need to create an area and a frame, a 4x4 handbreadth, and fill the water from inside it. So, therefore, he brought the water toward that space and fill up the water in that spot. So now the foundation of this machloket. Ravuna amar motzi emen aziz kol shu memale kasavar karmelit me'ar amar shchinan ve'avir ha'mekom p'turu. Ravuna said that one can extend the projection from any side of field, because he maintained that we measure the karmelit from the sea floor, from the bottom. So therefore he can fill that. Now, Carmelit Me'ara Mashchinan, it's said that that this Carmelit, that this sea, it's bringing the from the ground, and the avir, the air, it's considering a place of exempt. Ubedinu, and the law, the ziz nameloli, that one should not recover a projectant because he is drawing water from exempt domain into a private domain. It's only when he will have a distinctive sign, so it's not come to throw water from Carmelit into a private domain. They said that he feel a receptacle in water and maintain that it's a measure of Carmelit and at the 4x4 and he filled it up, so it's not the issue of Carmelit. Kasavre Carmelit Misfadayam Maya Mashchinan. He maintained that the measure of Carmelit from the surface of the water, Maya Aras Michta, the water in the sea is a legal status like a solid land. Ilo Avet Bey Mekom Arba'a, if he does not create an area of 4x4, Kametaltel Mekarmelit Lo Shabim can carry from Carmelit to private domain. Amar Rav Nachman Rabba Bar Avuna, Ravuna, Damar Motzim Menaziz Kol Shum Male, Zilman Lega Asra, according to Avuna, when it is, it's sometimes that it's not 10 handbreadth deep. So the Kametal and Karmelit Lo Shabim is carrying from Karmelit to a private domain. Amar Gamrinan, the ends fina me'alechet bepachot me'asara. We hold that the boat is not going less than 10 handbreadth. Ve'ha morsha itlei. But although they boat is a boat has a protrusion and it's a bow in more than 10 embret above the sea floor, so which means the entire length of the boat is not necessarily that far from the bottom. Amarav Safra Gashoshe Azlei Kamarav Safra said, those people who measure the depth of the water with the long poles proceed before the ship and ensure that the water is at least 10 hand breadth deep. אמר לרב נחמן בר יצחק לרב חייא בר אבין לרב חיזה ולרב בר אבונה דאמרי עושה מקום ארבעה ומלא, according to those who say that he make the four field the area of 4x4 hand breadth and fill it שופכים דידי איך ישללו, so how does he throw out his waste water? As you know, it's always in the boiling business you have that. וחיתם על ישלל באותו מקום, if you say that he puts it out in the same area from which he draw water, and the water that he subsequently draw from there is what the meiselu is disgusting right to it. So they said the shallu adafnes fina, because they pour it onto the side of the boat. So they said ve'ika kocho, but it means that he still have his power. Kocho bekarmelit lo gazru, the sages did not issue a decree to prohibit an action performed on one's power on a carmelit. The Tanya sfina en metaltim lo metocha leyam velo meyam metocha. We learn that a ship one may not neither carry it into the sea nor from the into the sea. Rabbi Yudah amar amukasra ben gvoasra metaltrim tocha layam aval lo min hayam letocha. Rabbi Yudah said, if the interior of the bowl is a 10 hand breadth, we were on page 101, and deep and is not in 10 hand breadth above the surface of the water, one may carry it from the sea but not from the sea into it. And in Mitzvah Shem we explain in the next shiur, in the next daf, this sugya, this braita. Practical halachot.
Rabbi, I have a question. Specifically regarding like diving, scuba diving and so forth on Shabbat.
Okay, so scuba diving, that's a good question. So scuba diving, what happened is, if the whole piece is one piece, including the how do you call that part that you put on your eye?
The mask. Oh,
the mask. Okay. If it's all one entity, it's all one entity, lichora, you may say that it's not an issue. Let's say if you own that spot and you are on the boat for at least 3 days, like you go on those cruise, mm-hmm, and you have inside your big boat a place that you can do scuba diving, and it's all one piece, the issue is it's not in the spirit of Shabbat. It's incongruous for Shabbat. It's inappropriate. But if it's not a separate entity, it's not an issue of violation Torah law by any means. I saw you want to ask me another thing?
No.
Okay.
Yep.
No? That's it? Okay.
Yep.
So the next halacha is bo shechilku, a pit that was divided. So if one throw a mat from a public domain into a pit that is 10 hand breadths deep and exactly 8 hand breadth wide, and the mat split the pit into two equal holes, he is exempt. Why? Because when the mat land, it negates the pit status of a private domain. You remember we talked about it? And then we explain the difference between a pit that have fruits and pit will have the water. If one throw an object into a pit filled of water that has dimensions of a private domain, and the object landed on the water, he is liable because the water does not nullify the partitions of the pit and negates its status. But if the pit was full of fruit, he is exempt because the fruit nullifies the partitions of the pit and minimizes its size. So we said the public domain extends up to 10 hand breadth. The airspace higher than that is Mekom Ptu, is exempt domain. So if someone throwing an object into a wall, one who throw an object into a wall public domain and it lands above 10 hand breadth, he's exempt even if the object remains stuck in the wall. That's what Rabbi Yochanan said. And we said carving out of space to complete. If one throw an object and it lands in the hole in the wall in the public domain, his liability depends on the size of the wall. the whole. If the whole is too small to be considered domain itself, which means it's less than 400 wide and 10 hundred wide, is exempt. Otherwise, it's liable. Tel Amitlaket, we discussed the mound that was in inclined plane and gradually attained the height of 10 hundred. So he said, if that is over a horizontal space of 4 cubits, is considering private domain. So one who throw an object from public domain onto it is liable. We talk about alleyway, and we say that if an alleyway is slapped at the end, either inclining or declining to connect to the public domain, and disparity between the heights and the alleyway and that of the public domain is 10 handbreadth. So the Ravid said, if it's over the horizontal space of the 4 cubits, it's considering a partition between the two domains, and nothing more needs to be done to allow carrying in the valley. But if one throw an object into a public domain within 4 cubits, and then it rolls beyond the 4 cubits, he is exempt. Now the next halacha we learn, if someone throw a 4 cubit into the sea. So the Mishnah Berurah said, and also Shulchan Aruch HaRachaim 345, the legal status of both a sea and a river is that of a Carmelite. So one who throw an object 4 cubits into the Mont Shabbat is exempt, although it is prohibited to do so. How about a swamp? So we said water in a public domain that is less than 10 breadth deep, even if it is 4 cubits wide, it's part of a public domain. And most people walk through it. So we said also, if you have two boats, if you have two boats that tied together, so one may only carry an object from one boat to another, that adjoint boat, that they are tied together, or the upper edge of the boat are 10 handbreadths above the water. If the boat belongs to two different people, one may not carry between them, even if the sides of the 10 handbreadths above the water, unless adjoining courtyards has been established. That's the Rambam Hilchot Eruvim, chapter 3. So in the case that one who is on a boat on Shabbat and wants to draw water from the sea, if the sides of the boat are less than 10 handbreadths above the water, he must create an area of 4x4 handbreadths and carve a hole into it so he may be draw the water. But if the side of the boat are more than 10 handbreadths above the water, he extend the hole. So the Mishnah Berurah write that one can draw water even without a protrusion, because that protrusion serves merely as a reminder. That's the Rav Chisda said. But as we said earlier, all that apply only if you go 3 days in advance to that water. Now, how do you make a status of Carmelite? So he said Carmelite in the sea is a measure on the surface of the water, which is the disregard considered like the ground. So the Magen Avraham said, if one need to pour water other waste from the boat into the sea on Shabbat, he should not pour it directly into the sea, but should pull it into the side of the boat and let it run to the sea. What do you want to ask? Yes.
Yeah, I had just a general question on Shabbat about putting food on and off of blech. When can you put food on a blech during Shabbat, or does it always have to be before Shabbat that you put it on?
Excellent. Okay, so there is a machloket between Sfaradim and Ashkenazim, and it's good to know. Putting food on the blech has to be all before Shabbat. However, Rav Ovadia Yosef hold, the great Sephardic rabbi, that for dry items, for example, if you have on the blech, let's say a pot, we have food there, and you pull out, oh, I have too many guests come in, I need to take out from the refrigerator and put it, as long as it's a dry item, it's not liquid item, Rav Ovadia Yosef allow it for the Sfaradim. Ashkenazim that go by the Rema, they require to have it on the top of another. So for example, if you have a chont or you have anything that you want to do on Shabbat, you can turn around the pot the other way around, and you can put it on that, so it's not direct connection to the blech. As long as it's not direct connection to the blech, we as Ashkenazim say that it's fine in that way. Sfaradim, however, if they said if it's a dry, you can put it directly not on the blech, but on the pot that it's on the blech. So in other words, the best of the best is to put everything on a pot and you just selected it, because the minute you take it, it's an issue to return it.
Right.
But as we said, if you need to put it on, So we as Ashkenazim said, take that pot, turn it around, and put the item on the top of that pot. Hashem.